Hello everyone, today's video is inspired by a galactite over on Instagram who asks, can you have a binary planet pull a Uranus onto a vertical plane and still be stable? Now what I think they're asking here is, can you have a pair of binary planets orbiting in a plane perpendicular to their orbital plane? My initial answer to this question was that yes, I think so, as long as you're far enough away from this star. But I'm a scientist and I don't like guessing when I don't have to, so let's get into just what the considerations are for the stability of such a system. This is a quintessential example of the three-body problem, which basically comes down to the fact that it is literally impossible for any equation, no matter how long and complicated, to perfectly describe the motion of three bodies under the influence of gravity. The best we can do is approximate it via equations, or better yet, numerically using computers. Just one bonus of living in the modern age. Can you imagine how jealous Kepler would be of n-body simulations? Now, a lot of really smart people have been thinking about this problem for a really long time, so we actually have a pretty good idea of some of the conditions that are required for a three-body system to be stable. Most importantly, the system needs to be hierarchical. And this is not in terms of like an org chart, but it means there has to be a separation of scales. Two of the three bodies will have their own little orbit with one another, and then they together as a unit can be thought of as being in a larger orbit with the third body. I guess it kind of does end up looking like an orb chart. And a binary planet has a very small orbit relative to the orbit around the star, so we're good to go there. The other very important piece to consider is a little bit more complicated. Now, this effect was semi-independently discovered by several scientists back in the 1960s, so it's variously called the Kozai mechanism, the Kozai-Lidov effect, or even more rarely, sometimes the von Zeipel-Kozai-Lidov effect. Now the math here is fascinating, but you're just gonna have to take my word for it because I don't think that's a rabbit hole we need to go down in this video. But the important idea with Kozai-Lidov effect is one, that an orbit can exchange inclination and eccentricity, giving it really high eccentricities, like enough to crash a satellite into Earth as it passes too close during perigee. And two, this effect is triggered when the inclination is above some minimum inclination threshold, about 40 degrees. Uh-oh, we're talking about binary planets that have been tilted vertically? That's an inclination of 90 degrees, which is definitely above the minimum threshold to get Kozai-Lidov cycles. In fact, you get the strongest Kozai-Lidov cycles when you start at an inclination of 90. This would indeed be super destabilizing to the binary planets, as I discovered when I naively tried to simulate this configuration and it went unstable again and again and again. In fact, I had to scrap the original version of this video, which was supposed to be a tutorial on how you could set up and run this configuration in Rebound. But then I thought, no, we really need to talk about all of these effects that are happening here, but I will include the code below so that you can download it and try to run this yourself if you're interested. If you've never used Rebound before, I did a tutorial on how to get started with that, so you can check that out. Okay, so our binary planets are doomed because they're too inclined, right? Well, for that matter, wait a minute, why aren't the moons of Uranus yeeted off into oblivion because of this very same thing? For one thing, distance, like I said in my original answer. The farther you move your binary system away from the star, the weaker the perturbations from the star are and the more stable the system can be. For example, this is a simulation where I tried to put a pair of Earth-like binary planets at 1 AU. What you can see here is that the eccentricity gets excited very quickly and actually the planets end up colliding in literally only 2.5 years. However, moving those same Earths out to 10 AU, and again we get the eccentricity excited very quickly and the planets end up colliding, although it does take a little bit longer this time, we're at about 7,000 years. Moving them out even further to 50 AU, and we don't even see those Kozai-Lidov cycles getting triggered. At least not on this timescale, which you can see is actually only about 100,000 years. This actually took over a week to simulate. If we really zoom in on the y-axis of these top two plots, we can actually see that there is a little bit of eccentricity inclination exchange, but this is very zoomed in. We're talking about a scale here of about 10 to the minus 6 for eccentricity and 0.05 degrees for the inclination. The weaker effect from being so far away from the star really increases the time scales involved in the Kozai-Lidov cycling. All of these pairs, by the way, were separated by 0.005 AU, which is about twice the distance between the Earth and the Moon. But even more important is the fact that so far we've just been talking about point masses, which is basically when you consider the entire mass of the planet or the star as occupying the area of the center of its mass with basically no radius. Which is a great approximation in a lot of cases, but the real world sadly does have a lot of complications, spherical cows and all that. Which brings us back to Uranus. So an important factor here is that Uranus is not a perfect sphere, it's actually oblate, that is, it's wider at its equator. That oblateness of Uranus affects its gravitational field, and that can actually keep its moons stable against Kozai-Lidov. Although, fun fact, at least one moon of Uranus is actually not safe from Kozai-Lidov at all. The moon Margaret is in a Kozai resonance and can reach eccentricities as high as 0.87. And actually, you don't need a lot of oblateness to help prevent Kozai-Lidov cycling. This was actually investigated for close binary asteroids, and they found even a small amount of oblateness in the asteroids can prevent them from getting destabilized by Kozai-Lidov. Another important consideration for real planets, tides. As the eccentricity increases, the planets start to get really close to one another during that pericenter passage, sometimes just a few radii apart. This raises tides on the planets, which causes tidal friction. That friction basically helps shrink and circularize the orbits, drawing the planets very close together and making them tidally locked. This eventually actually stops the Kozai cycling and leaves the final orbit at an inclination of 40-ish degrees. Okay, so where does all of this leave us with our vertical binary planets? Well, if they're sufficiently far from the host star and close enough together, you can actually have a vertical orbit for the binary planets, but it's really difficult to get them to stay that way unless they are super close together and have some amount of oblateness to prevent the Kozai-Lidov effect. Because oblateness usually comes from spinning, that means their spin axes also need to be tilted, like Uranus. Also, you may be wondering, stability of it all aside, is it even possible to create this sort of binary terrestrial planet system like we've been talking about? Actually, yes, we think so. So there was a study that was done that showed that binary terrestrial planets can form under certain conditions during terrestrial planetary formation. So just maybe out there somewhere, there is in fact a planet where you would see this in the night sky every night, which is pretty cool. Whew, that ended up being a lot more than I originally thought we were going to be getting into, but this is honestly my favorite subject in the entire world, orbital dynamics. I literally did my whole PhD on it, so thank you so much for coming along on this ride with me. I hope you learned a little bit of something, and I will see you again soon. Bye!